Digital history, I would define it as history that incorporates digital techniques to find information, to find new insights. For me, actually, I don't really think of digital history as separate from history. I think of digital history as, you know, just another way of finding information and parsing information for historical insight. You know, just as you would do an analytical analysis of some numbers. You wouldn't call it analytical history per se. You know, it's just another set of techniques that can take any number of forms depending on what digital tools you take. But I don't think we like to think of it as a separate subset of history. I think it's a part of how we do history. That's I think the essence of what good digital history is finding, using techniques that allow you to find insights that you otherwise wouldn't have. What I find most interesting and most powerful right now about digital techniques that are out there are tools, mapping tools, things that allow you to visualize information in ways that are different than what you could do before, and then layer multiple sets of information on top of each other to see what correlations there might be. If you can take a map of a place, like Texas, where my research is done, and then you can map the population onto that. And then you can layer other sets of information that are ostensibly unrelated to that population, like where the rivers are, what the land values are, things like that. You can start to see, you know, a population database, what is that? How does that relate to other information sets, like land values, things like that? Are people settling in areas that are the best for growing whatever it is they're growing on their farms, or are they settling in other places for other reasons? And so being able to layer those pieces of information on top of each other and see simultaneous patterns emerge is what I think is one of the most interesting techniques and the most useful stuff you can do. Entirely by accident, I arrived at the University of Virginia because I wanted to study the American South and slavery. It's a great place to do it, and I wanted to work with one of the best scholars there are out there, Edward Ayers. And so I had no intention of working with digital stuff whatsoever. But when I arrived on campus and started working with Ed, he started telling me about his project, the Valley of the Shadow project, and he asked me if I wanted to work on it one summer because I needed some people to do some transcription work. And I said, sure, I need some money, you know? And I started working on it, and, you know, I came at it from one angle of just, you know, feeding myself. But as I'm working on it, I started realizing just the possibilities there are here for all kinds of different sort of insight in dealing with these sources that we were used to dealing with in an analog sort of way, but if you take it into a digital format, it offers new opportunities. And so it was from that experience working on his project that I began to think in different ways about my own work, and has led me to doing the stuff that I'm doing today. For my research, I've used digital techniques to try to bring to the surface what the information, like population database, might say if we used it and correlated it to other sets of information. What I'm trying to do is use the digital techniques to provide myself a microscope of sorts to look into the data that I already have in ways that otherwise I couldn't have done. The way that hard sciences have microscopes to investigate, you know, the things that they're looking into. And so for me, it's very much a part of discovering information and trying to parse things out, and a part of the process of putting together what these different pieces of information that have survived really mean when you tie them together using digital techniques. And in my teaching, it informs it two ways. One, what I'm saying to my students is different based on the research I've done using digital techniques. You know, the dissertation that I'm writing, the books that I'll be writing, have different interpretations, I think, because the evidence that I'm using and finding is different because I'm using these digital things. But it also encourages me, I think, to engage the students to also work with information in the digital format at times when it's appropriate, not always, but when it's appropriate. I've built with Ed and a few other people at the University of Virginia a project that's sort of a wiki-style research project for graduates or for undergraduates, where they do research over the course of a semester and then upload those essays into a database that they can all search and have access to. And what that does is that breaks down the barriers of collaboration in the classroom and allows students to write a paper at the end of the semester, not based on just their own research, but on the corpus of everybody in that entire class that they've accumulated. And the idea in all of this stuff is to break down artificial barriers that exist when you work in just an analog environment. When you go into a digital world, the fluidity of all these things allows for new possibilities. I think it does both, but I think digital history has more of a different audience than they do traditional audience. There are a growing number of traditional historians who are beginning to see, I think, possibilities in digital stuff, particularly as primary sources that were hard for them to get if they didn't go to another archive, they can now get online if they just hit their desktop and surf the web, are starting to see more possibilities there, and for that reason are more interested in digital techniques. But I still think that, you know, where we are right now, 2007, is a place where scholarship and interpretation based on digital stuff doesn't have as wide an audience and isn't as accepted yet, in part because there's just not much of it. And there aren't a lot of great examples. There are some fantastic examples. But as far as pure numbers are concerned, there's just not a lot of it out there. And I think until there's more of a body of these things that work well, that do things that you couldn't do in an analog environment, where people can see firsthand how this stuff really does open new possibilities, when that happens, we will be getting a much wider audience and much more of a the traditional historians, I guess you could say, invited in or taking part. History can go any number of directions. And the one thing that's so exciting about the digital age is it opens possibilities to us that we haven't had in disseminating history, processing history, and just making sense of the past. What history is, really, is taking all of these bits of the past and shaking them up and making sense of them. And the way we've almost always done that are in books and articles. These are the established formats which we do this stuff. But it doesn't have to be that way. This opens up new possibilities not only for interpreting things, but presenting things. And the rules aren't set yet as to how those things have to happen. And so you have this kind of crazy time, really, where you have new possibilities of being able to try all kinds of experimental ways of information processing and display and interpretation that can go any number of directions. But basically, when you live in a world of ones and zeros that can be manipulated any way you want, truly your imagination is the limit of all of this stuff, which is what's so exciting, I think.